Good afternoon, everyone. We are going to discuss some, we have done some part of pediatric surgical problems like omphalocele and other things. But there are some others which are left, so I will try to cover today common pediatric surgical conditions. So we will begin with the common presentations, that is inguinoscrotal disorders. The most common are inguinal hernias in children, almost always indirect due to a patent processus vaginalis. Now we always understand that an indirect hernia comes through the internal ring, through the superficial ring, and then into the scrotum through the same passage where there is descent of the testis. So because that passage is still remaining patent, so they develop a hernia. Whereas a direct hernia, it originates by weakness of the posterior wall. It's a direct protrusion. So they are more frequent in boys, especially if premature. And if it is, yes, of course, because of the descent of the testis, the pathway is there, so they will be present mostly in boys, especially if they were born prematurely. And they are more, an inguinal hernia will develop in at least 1 in 50 boys, and about 15% of them are bilateral, so both sides. Rarely bilateral inguinal hernia in a phenotypic girl may be presenting a feature of androgen insensitivity syndrome, testicular feminization, and the hernia sac may contain a testis. Now, an inguinal hernia typically causes a swelling that is intermittent. It comes out and goes in the groin or during the scrotum while crying or straining. Unlike a hydrocele, which is constantly, there is a constant swelling. So, a herniation, if the patient lies down or it disappears and the child walks or cries, then it appears. When there is increased intra-abdominal pressure, then the swelling appears, unlike in hydrocele. So unless an inguinal swelling is observed, the diagnosis relies on the history and the presence of a palpable thickening of the spermatic cord or round ligament in girls. Some inguinal hernias present as a firm, tender, irreducible lump in the groin or scrotum because of incarceration that has become obstructed there at the external ring. So the swelling, whether it's a testis, or maybe if it is a testis, or maybe if it is a bowel loop, it is caught, it is incarcerated, it cannot move. So this is a bad sign. So the infant may be irritable and begin to vomit. Most incarcerated, obstructed or obstructed hernias in children can be successfully reduced by sustained gentle compression, that is taxis. The swelling can be pressed gently into the abdomen, aided by cautious analgesia. That is, you give adequate pain relief. Repair is usually delayed for 24 hours to let the edema settle. If it's not at all reducible after you have performed taxis, then emergency surgery is required, that is herniotomy is required, because of the risk of vascular compromise of the bowel, ovary or testis. Because if they remain strangulated for a long period of time, then the blood supply to the bowel, to the ovary, to the testis, whichever is the content of the hernia, will be threatened. And that organ can undergo infarction, and finally it can gangrene will develop. Summary: so more common in prematurely born boys, 15% of them is bilateral. They are usually indirect hernia with a patent processus vaginalis. Usually this processus vaginalis becomes obliterated soon after birth, but in some cases it can persist, and so the child might develop a hernia. Now, a groin lump appears on straining or crying, but disappears on lying down and when the child is relaxed. So that is an indication of herniation. Incarcerated inguinal hernias can usually be reduced with gentle pressure. We already discussed taxis. In infants, they can transilluminate like a hydrocele, making the test redundant when the distinction is difficult. So in infants, some hernias can, there can be transillumination when you use a strong light. There can be transillumination suggesting that it is a hydrocele. So this we have to be careful, because when we do surgery for hydrocele, we may even cut the content of the hernia, and that can be bowel also. If reduction is impossible, emergency surgery has to be performed. Infants need repair promptly to prevent the risk of strangulation, and the hernial sac is isolated, ligated, and it is divided. So here is just to give you a picture. You can see there it is the hernial sac, and what is going in as the content is the bowel, and it's going as close to the testis. So here There is in one side the track is patent to the point that the bowel can go into the scrotal sac, and in the picture B there is a thin patent tract. Sometimes when it's so thin, no content goes inside, but some fluid from the abdomen goes through the patent processes vaginalis, and what happens is you get a hydrocele. So another common problem that we encounter in infants is an undescended testis. So at birth, about 4% of full-term boys, that means boys who are not born prematurely, who have been carried full-term, have unilateral or bilateral undescended testis. One side or maybe both sides, the testis are not present in the scrotum. But by the age of 1 year, less than 1%, as it changes little thereafter. That means by the age of 1 year, most of them, very few, less than 1% of children might have an undescended testis. The incidence is higher in preterm infants because the testis descends through the inguinal canal during the third trimester. A normal testis reaches the base of the scrotum with a good length of cord above it. Testis cannot be palpated in the inguinal canal but can be milked from there into the superficial pouch, that is palpable undescended testis, or into the scrotum with a good length of cord. If the cord is of normal length, then it can be milked from the inguinal canal into the superficial pouch if the cord is of a good length. Now a retractile testis can be manipulated. A retractile testis can be manipulated into the base of the scrotum without tension, but it's pulled up by the cremaster muscle. So a retractile testis, as the name suggests, it gets retracted upwards when the cremastic muscle contracts. So with time, retractile testis reside permanently in the scrotum like any normal testis. However, follow-up is advisable as rarely the testis ascends into the inguinal canal. So you need to just monitor these children who has got a retractile testis, that it does not get retracted and stays permanently into the inguinal canal, because that is not its normal position. And the risk of developing other problems, such as testicular atrophy and even malignancy, is also higher. The ascending testis needs an orchidopexy, which means that it needs, pexy means fixing, which needs to be fixed. An ectopic testis lies outside its normal line of descent, often in the perineum. So a retractile testis reaches the base of the scrotum but retracts. An undescended testis may be palpable or impalpable. An ectopic testis lies outside. So you have three things. One is undescended testis. Another one is a testis that has descended but gets retracted upwards because of muscular contraction. Another one is an ectopic testis, which is not present in its normal position, and it's outside of the normal line of descent. Palpable undescended testis undergo a single stage orchidopexy. So if you are able to feel the testis anywhere in the inguinal canal, the patient can undergo a single stage operation of orchidopexy, or fixing it into the scrotum. Whereas a testis which is not palpable usually is high up and does not have enough length of cord. So this may require two-stage operation. Orchidopexy is usually performed around the age of 1 year when the testis has not descended. So fertility, to optimize spermatogenesis, the testis need to be in the scrotum below body temperature at a young age. So we understand that if the testis remains in the inguinal canal, which is not its normal position, the testicular function will be reduced, and also the risk of malignancy is more. Orchidopexy around 1 year of age is currently recommended. Fertility after orchidopexy for unilateral undescended testis is almost more or less like a normally descended testis. So men with a history of bilateral intra-abdominal testis are often infertile because of reduced spermatogenesis. Maybe the amount of sperm is less, or the sperm quality is poor. Malignancy. Undescended testis are histologically abnormal and at an increased risk of developing cancer. The greatest risk is for bilateral intra-abdominal testis. So the greatest risk to develop testicular cancer is in an adult who has got intra-abdominal testis on both sides. The testis never descended and they were never corrected also surgically. So early orchidopexy for a unilateral undescended testis may reduce the risk, but this is also not proven. Cosmetic and psychological. In an older boy, A prosthetic testis can be inserted to replace an absent one. So this is just for cosmetic and psychological support in a person whom does not have a testis on one side, or maybe the testis has been attempted and it has very small or removed. So a prosthetic testis may be inserted, may be placed inside the scrotum just to give cosmetic and psychological satisfaction. So another common problem is hypospadias. In hypospadias seen in 1 to 300 boys, the urethra opens proximally and ventrally. So urethra opens much, not at the tip of the, not at the tip of the penis, but much more proximally. And also not at the center, but in the ventral side. Most common, the opening is just proximal, is proximal to the glands, but it can open on the penile shaft or into onto the perineum. It is attributed to failure of complete urethral tubularization in the fetus. The foreskin is definitely ventrally, and there is a variable degree of chordae, a ventral curvature of the penis most apparent on erection. Glandular hypospadias needs correction for cosmetic reasons, but more proximal anomalies interfere with micturition and erection. Distal hypospadias is usually repaired before 2 years of age in one or two stages. Proximal varieties require complex staged procedures. Surgery aims to achieve a terminal urethral meatus so that the boy can stand to micture it with a normal stream, a straight erection, and a penis that looks normal. So ritual circumcision is contraindicated in infants with hypospadias because the foreskin is often required for the reconstruction. Now, sorry, I forgot to put a picture of how a hypospadias looks like. Next time, I will put a picture and show you. So infantile hypertrophic pyloric stenosis is a very interesting problem. It's quite common also. Infantile IHPS presents with non-bilious projectile vomiting between 2 and 8 weeks of age and is only rarely seen after 13 weeks. It is easily distinguished from many other serious causes of vomiting such as infections because the baby is particularly hungry. And because why is particularly hungry? Whenever the baby is fed, immediately it vomits. The baby has been given milk, breast milk, and immediately is given, the baby vomits it out. So it's persistently hungry. So we need to take a detailed history to distinguish from the more common gastroesophageal reflux, which is common in infancy. It affects one in 300 infants with a male to female ratio of 4:1. So you understand that male infants are more prone to have this problem, especially if it's the first child. IHPS can be diagnosed clinically. During a test feed, there is visible gastric peristalsis. When the baby is sucking milk, you can see that the stomach produces peristalsis which are visible, passing from the left to the right across the upper abdomen. And in a relaxed baby, when the child is not feeding, the pyloric tumor, it's not actually a tumor, but it is basically a hypertrophic pyloric muscle that presents as a lump, is palpable as an olive in the right upper abdomen. So the diagnosis can be confirmed by an ultrasound, which shows a thickened pyloric muscle. You can see that the pyloric muscle is so thick, there a pyloromyotomy has been done. So you can see the outer muscular layer has been cut, and what remains inside that light pink thing is the mucosa. So you can see the muscle on top, the serosa and the muscular layer has been cut, and so as to allow expansion, but the mucosa is not cut and it's preserved. Otherwise, the patient will have peritonitis if the mucosa is cut. So IPHS is readily treated by surgery, but the infant must be adequately hydrated and the hypochloremic alkalosis is corrected. So Ramstedt's pyloromyotomy is performed and you give an incision here and preserving the, you can see it's a very simple surgery. You just identify the thickened pyloric ring and you pull it out and then you just give an incision, but caution has to be exercised not to cut the mucosa. And the child can feed as soon as it's completely awakened from anesthesia. So most commonly affect boys and among the age group of 2 to 8 weeks. So it's a problem that happens within 2 months of time. Projectile vomiting after feeds is one of the classic presentation. Test feed or ultrasound to confirm the diagnosis. That means you feed the child, give breast milk, and you will see the visible gastric peristalsis. Or an ultrasound will confirm the thickened pyloric muscle. Gastric peristalsis can be seen and an olive is felt. So these are very strong clinical findings to suggest IHPS. Hyperchlorimetabolic alkalosis must be corrected before the operation. Pyloromyotomy splits the hypertrophic muscle, leaving the mucosa intact. It's called Ramstedt's pyloromyotomy. Another common surgical problem is the intussusception. Most intussusceptions in children are seen from 2 months to 2 years of age. They are life-threatening. Intussusception basically means that a bowel has telescoped into a bowel. Okay, just like a telescope. A telescope you've seen, you can pull it out and then you can put it in. So it's something similar like that. The bowel loop has gone inside itself. So intussusception typically causes a strangulating bowel. So strangulation means it's compressing and compromising the vascular supply. It will cause obstruction, which can progress to gangrene and finally perforation, leading to peritonitis. So gangrene, because why? There is a compromise in the vascularity due to edema. In children, more than 80% are ileocolic. That means the ileum, the terminal ileum, telescopes inside the colon through the cecum, beginning several centimeters proximal to the ileocecal valve. That means here the ileocecal valve mechanism is weak. So the ileum goes inside the colon, because you see the peristaltic waves also goes from the ileum into the peristaltic movements also are like that, to propel the fecal matter from the ileum into the colon. So what happens sometimes when there are inflamed lymph nodes, these can act as nodal points where and take along the ileum, the small bowel, into the large bowel, with the apex found in the ascending or transverse colon. So you can understand that a long length of ileum usually enters into the colon, and the tip of it can be found even up to the transverse colon. So in the majority, the cause is hyperplasia of PS patches, lymphoid tissue, which may be secondary to a viral infection. In 10% of children, intussusception is secondary to a pathological lead point such as Meckel's diverticulum, etc. So here you can see very nicely, you can see ileocolic intussusception causing small bowel obstruction. Now you can see the bowel has gone into itself. Here it is a case of ileocolic. This is operated here. We see the bowel is viable. And you can see here the ileum has gone into the colon. If you can see a little away from the operative site, there is a small, very small tubular structure. Probably that is the appendix arising from the cecum. So here what we do is we attempt to milk. We don't pull the intussusceptum. The intussusceptum is the one that goes inside. We don't try to pull out, but we push from the colonic side. We push it out. We try to push it out, because the bowel is inflamed and it may get torn. So the presentation of intussusception is bilious vomiting, because it happens well beyond the duodenum. So bile, of course, will come up. In an infant, it's a sign of intestinal obstruction until proved otherwise. Intussusception classically presents with colicky pain and vomiting. Intussusception should be considered in any infant with bloody stools. So there is a transudation of this of blood from the intestine into the mucosa. The age range is between 2 months and 2 years. So classically, a previously healthy infant presents with colicky pain and vomiting, usually initially vomiting milk and then vomits bile. Between episodes, the child initially appears well. Later, then he may pass a red currant jelly stool, something similar like a jam. Clinically, signs, this red currant jelly stool is nothing but a mixture of intestinal mucus with blood. So clinical signs include dehydration, abdominal distension, and a palpable sausage-shaped mass in the right upper quadrant. This palpable sausage-shaped mass in the right upper quadrant is specific to an ileocolic ileocolic intussusception. Now, rectal examination may reveal blood or rarely the apex of intussusception. Sometimes the apex, sometimes in the case of like a colocolic or a colorectal intussusception, if you do a rectal examination, you may be able to feel the tip of the intussusceptum. So a plain radiograph is a plain X-ray is rarely requested, but if done, it commonly shows signs of small bowel obstruction and a soft tissue opacity. Diagnosis is confirmed on an abdominal ultrasound, which will show you a target sign as a bowel within bowel. So this target sign you will observe in the ultrasound. After resuscitation with intravenous fluid, broad spectrum antibiotics and nasogastric drainage, non-operative reduction is attempted using an air edema. So you need to give IV fluids to rehydrate the patient because they've been vomiting. Broad spectrum antibiotics has to be given because there is transudation of intestinal fluid from the lumen into the bloodstream. And nasogastric drainage, you need to decompress the stomach so that to reduce the gastric distension. So non-operative reduction can be performed using an air enema, that is insufflating air through the rectum, or maybe fluid can be done. Successful reduction is recognized if air flows into the small bowel. You will see it in X-ray or fluoroscopy. Together with later resolution of symptoms and signs, the child feels relieved. An air enema is contraindicated if there is peritonitis, perforation or shock. Now this kind of non-operative reduction using air or fluid passing through the rectum is not indicated if the patient already has signs of peritonitis, that is guarding, rigidity, fever and perforation, or perforation where you have resonant absent clinically, you feel the liver dullness is not there anymore, or the patient is in shock. These patients have to be optimized as early as possible and taken up for operation. More than 70% of intussusceptions can be reduced non-operatively. So here you can see an air edema. Air is being insufflated through the rectum, and this air pushes the intussusceptum. It pushes the intussusceptum back, and then you will see if it's successful. Then you will see air has gone into the small bowel also. The arrow marks the soft tissue shadow of the intussusceptum. Strangulated bowel and pathological lead points are unlikely to reduce. And if the intussusception has been there for a long time and there is much edema, it will not be able to push the intussusceptum back, and this may require operative intervention. So perforation of the colon during pneumatic reduction is a recognized hazard. It is rare though, and this has to be kept in mind. Even after you have done a pneumatic reduction, the patient may be advised to be hospitalized and observed and not feel fed immediately, because if there's a small perforation of the colon has a huge bacterial load, and then the fecal peritonitis will set in and the child will go very quickly into septicemia. So this has to be monitored. Recurrent intussusception occurs in up to 5% of patients after non-operative reduction. Now you see what happened is, once intussusception has happened, it can happen again because the bowel is left like that, how it was. And the chance of reduction is also, the chance of it happening again is there. Whereas if you intervene surgically, you fix the intussusceptum, you fix the bowel so that repeat intussusception doesn't occur. If an operative reduction is needed, this is usually performed by open operation, that is not laparoscopically. The intussusception is milked distally by gentle compression from its apex. That's what we already told you. You feel the tip of the intussusceptum from the bowel, and you just push it gently. Both the intussusceptum and the intussusceptions are inspected for areas of non-viability. If you see that peristalsis is absent or there is a change in color, then it's prudent to wait and confirm that there is no vascular compromise. Otherwise, when you have reduced the intussusception, you have closed the abdomen, the bowel very soon after in the post-operative period, the bowel will undergo gangrene. Then there is no point. You have to intervene again. So if you recognize that there is an irreducible intussusception or one that is complicated by infarction or a pathological lead point requires resection, it's better to resect that part of non-viable bowel and perform a primary anastomosis to re-establish intestinal continuity. So in summary, bilious vomiting in an infant is a sign of intestinal obstruction unless proved otherwise. Intussusception classically presents with colicky pain and vomiting. Intussusception should be considered in any infant with bloody stools. Age range is between 2 months and 2 years. A plain radiograph is rarely requested, but if done, it commonly shows signs of small bowel obstruction and a soft tissue opacity. So this soft tissue opacity represents the bowel within bowel. So on ultrasound, you will see this target sign. After resuscitation with intravenous fluids, broad continuation of broad spectrum antibiotics and a nasogastric drainage, non-operative reduction is attempted using fluid or air enema. Successful reduction is recognized if the air or fluid is seen, or the fluid with it, which is tagged with a contrast agent so that you can see in fluoroscopy. So management is bowel infarction will result without if not treated. Most of the times it is ileocolic, that is the ileum, it goes inside the colon. Diagnosis can be confirmed by ultrasound scan. Fluid and electrolyte resuscitation is essential. Most intussusceptions can be reduced non-operatively using air enema. If there are signs of peritonitis, perforation, then emergency operation, open operation is performed. So we will come to some interesting common congenital problems. Number one is congenital diaphragmatic hernia. Typically in congenital diaphragmatic hernia or CDH, there is a left-sided posterior lateral diaphragmatic defect allowing herniation of abdominal viscera into the chest. This is usually called the Bogdalex foramen or Bogdalex hernia. I forgot to mention it. The other one, this is a posterior lateral. The other one, which happens in the anterior medial, which is less which is less common, is the Morgani hernia. This is Bogdalex hernia, which happens in the left-sided posterior lateral defect, allowing herniation of abdominal viscera, that is the spleen, the stomach, the transverse colon, and into the left thorax. So many are detected antenatally, that is during antenatal ultrasound scanning, anomaly scanning, and the prognosis relates to the severity of associated pulmonary hypoplasia. Now, because the intra-abdominal viscera, they herniate. Now, this is one kind of herniation which happens from against gravity. So this is one kind of herniation which happens against gravity. So because the abdominal viscera, they occupy the left thorax, there is the lung on the left side does not get a chance to grow. It gets obstructed. So the lung on the left side becomes very small. It is hypoplasia. So what happens, even if you perform an operation and you reduce all these viscera into the abdomen, it's like the patient is living only on one lung. So the child will have respiratory distress. So mainly the complication is because of pulmonary hypoplasia resulting in dyspnea. So despite intensive respiratory support or extracorporeal membrane oxygenation, up to 30% of babies with a CDH die from respiratory failure, because a single lung cannot support life. If the baby can be stabilized, the diaphragmatic defect is repaired. Small diaphragmatic hernias may present with respiratory or gastrointestinal symptoms later in childhood. So this is how it looks like. You can see that on the right side, the lung is normally developed, but on the left side, you hardly see any lung tissue. It looks like a pulmonary aplasia. It looks like that, as if there's no lung, and the rest of it looks as if the rest of the whole of the viscera from the abdomen has gone into the left thorax. That's why you can see it's dark, because intestines contain air. So incidence of selected malformations in the thorax, you have congenital diaphragmatic hernia, which can be Bogdalex hernia or Morgani's hernia. Its incidence is 1:3000. Esophageal atresia, tracheal fistula, esophageal fistula 1:3500. Cardiac congenital heart disease is common, 1 in 150 childbirths. Gastrointestinal gastrochisis, we have covered this, 1 in 7,500, not so common. Hirschsprung's disease is also not so common. We will be discussing it next class. Anorectal formations, 1 is to 4 to 5,000, whereas there is biliary atresia, 1 is to 17,000. Polydocal cysts, 1 is to 50,000. Hypospadias, 1 is to 300, very common. Pelvic-uretric junction dysfunction, 1 is to urodigital, that is 1 is to 1,000. So quite common. So we will end the class today here. And next class we will be covering, and hopefully we can finish all the other pediatric surgical problems. So thank you.